We want to see if models are good at performing tasks that have a high economic value that a lot of people care about. And so sometimes benchmarks might be a bit artificial or measure skills that are way more specific than maybe the subject that they are a part of. If the benchmark measures only a very small component, maybe a component that's difficult for humans, but that's only a tiny part of what it means to actually perform the task in an economically useful way, then I would say the benchmark is going to be not difficult enough and not realistic or useful enough for our purposes. So I think historically, a lot of progress in AI has been driven by good benchmarking. If we look back at ImageNet, for example, I think it was like pretty key to the very fast progress we got to like in deep learning in the mid-2010s. So when benchmarking is broken and benchmark performance is not a reliable indicator of how good models actually are, then it becomes much harder to improve on models. It also becomes much harder for people who don't have extensive experience interacting with the models to get a general sense of how well they perform. And so I think this is both an issue from the perspective of wanting more progress in AI, but also an issue from the point of view of other people who want to track what is happening and get a sense of model capabilities, of potentially the risks that are posed by models. So I think there's a few different difficulties with benchmarking and evaluation. And current benchmarks, I would say first, are not difficult enough in many cases. So we have a problem of saturation, where a lot of leading models have extremely high scores on the most famous benchmarks. And this makes it harder to interpret which model is better than the others, and more generally to understand AI progress. Because if two models are actually very different in terms of like how useful they are in the real world, but have very similar and very high scores, then the benchmark is not very useful. So that's the first problem, which is difficulty. A related problem is realism, which is to say, at Epoch, we care about the impact of AI models in the real world and whether, for instance, they would be able to automate a lot of jobs. And so for this, we want to see if models are good at performing tasks that have a high economic value that a lot of people care about. And so sometimes benchmarks might be a bit artificial or measure skills that are way more specific than maybe the subject that they are a part of. And this is often related to difficulty, which is to say, performing a task in the real world can be very difficult for sometimes unexpected reasons. And if the benchmark measure is only a very small component, maybe a component that's difficult for humans, but that's only a tiny part of what it means to actually perform the task in an economically useful way, then I would say the benchmark is going to be not difficult enough and not realistic or useful enough for our purposes. So one final problem with existing benchmarks and evaluations that's very frequent is the issue of contamination, or more generally, overfitting. So often the benchmarks are public, and for very prominent benchmarks, everybody has access to the test questions that are used to rate models. And this poses a problem because sometimes models will be either intentionally or not intentionally trained on the answers to these questions. And this means that models will often have very high scores, not because they're actually able to answer these questions in a way that would transfer to other related scenarios in the real world, but because they've merely memorized these answers. And so this makes it quite misleading sometimes and hard to interpret the results of these evaluations. Even if it's not literally that models have memorized the answers, often because we know what the benchmarks are and the kinds of questions that they ask, there's a temptation, conscious or unconscious, to, you know, increase the prevalence in the training data of other questions and topics that are closely related to the benchmarks. And sometimes that does give models real skills, but these skills might be skewed towards the particular questions in the benchmark in a way that also makes interpreting the results more complicated. Yeah, so as an example, I'd give GSM8K. So that's an elementary school mathematics benchmark that was designed by OpenAI in 2021. And that was very useful to catalyze work on mathematics. But the problems are often fairly similar, and they're just generally pretty easy. I haven't checked the latest numbers, but my guess is that models perform maybe at 98, 99% of the solve rate, at least the best models currently. So much so that I think few model developers now actually report the scores of the best models, like 01 on GSM8K. You know, it's a fairly recent benchmark, in the sense that it's 2021, but in AI time, 2021 to 2024 is just a very large amount of time. I think this problem is compounded in the case of GSM8K by contamination issues, where papers have shown that models perform unusually well in GSM8K, even compared to problems that come from the same distribution as GSM8K, but weren't in the original test set. And this shows some amount of contamination, which, again, might not be exact memorization, but still also increases this problem and makes saturation more likely. So this is a good example, I think, of a benchmark that's currently saturated, both because, you know, its level of difficulty has been exceeded by the very rapid progress we've seen, and also because of these contamination concerns, or overfitting concerns, maybe more generally. Part of it has been that progress has been faster than most people anticipated. I think the AI community sometimes, you know, did not look ahead progress that would occur and therefore build evaluations that just don't have a very long shelf life. So I think that's at least a part of the problem there. But it's also genuinely difficult and very costly to build benchmarks and evaluations that are very hard. You know, it makes it more difficult for academics to do this. And so that's maybe part of the reason as well why the current benchmarks we have, you know, tended to be saturated. So I think this would depend on what you want to use the benchmark for. So, you know, there are a few different use cases. Some people will design benchmarks to really measure the differences between models and try to have very high resolution to detect even small improvements. And this is useful because it can incentivize a lot of people to evaluate their different methods on the benchmark and even detect, you know, like marginal increases in performance. And for this, you would need, for instance, a very high sample size to be able to detect these small improvements. Now, that's one property you might care about in these cases. And I think difficulty, as I mentioned previously, having difficult benchmarks is useful because it tends to lead to longer shelf lives for your benchmarks. Then there's the contamination issue that I mentioned as well. And so for this, you might want to, for instance, have a private test set or holding out your set, or, you know, there's other interventions that are a bit weaker but allow you to share your data still, like sharing it but forcing people to log in to a particular website to see the benchmark, or having canary strings as well. So there's, I think, different levels of measures you can take against contamination. I think the best one is probably having a private test set, a held out set that you can keep and use to measure the performance on models and use it to track whether there's a contamination happening. I think it depends on the purpose that you're using it for. Another use case that people have for benchmarks is to measure particular levels of risk, where they have a threat model in mind, and then they'll use the benchmark to see if, you know, the model is capable enough to cause a certain harm or likely to do a certain harm. And I think for these, a key property that you'd want is, you know, for the benchmark to actually be connected to the threat model, even without thinking about risks. I think one thing that we care about at Epoch is, you know, automation due to AI and whether AIs are able to perform economically productive tasks. And similarly here, we want the tasks that are evaluated by the benchmark to be highly connected to actually producing economic value. Yeah, so I think there's a lot of different settings and parameters that people can use during evaluation. And sometimes even small changes to these settings can make a big difference in what the outputs of the models are and therefore what the scores that they have on these benchmarks. So one example of this is temperature, which is a parameter that people can change that roughly determines how random model outputs are. And so if you use a temperature of, say, 0 or a temperature of 1, your model generations will be quite different and your scores in the benchmark might be quite different. And it's not necessarily that a temperature of 0 is bad or good or a temperature of 1 is bad or good, but it's just pretty important to keep in mind that that particular parameter was set in a way to therefore be careful when comparing the results of two evaluations. Now, another example of a parameter is the prompt, which is to say the way that the question was formatted, as you were saying, the sentence that is used to give the model an instruction, to present the problem, to ask it to explain its reasoning in a particular way, or how it should format the answer. Similarly, that prompt can have a large effect on what the model's answer looks like and therefore what the score of the model is on the benchmark. Yeah, I mean, I think it's just like, you know, pretty hard to keep track of everything by default. I mean, sometimes, you know, it's just that different people are using different settings because they correspond to different needs. You know, those evaluations are equally defensible, and you have to be careful when interpreting or aggregating them. So, you know, if someone performed the evaluation of temperature zero because that, for some reason, is the setting that they care about, and someone else performed it with temperature one, I think you want to keep that in mind and not kind of naively average these results, for instance. So it doesn't have to be an error on the part of the person who performed the evaluation, but it might make it more difficult to interpret. Yeah, so my understanding of responsible scaling policies and other frontier safety frameworks is that they often rely on making decisions conditional on models having particular capabilities. And the idea is generally that if models pose a certain level of risk, then you want to have safeguards that are adapted to that level of risk. And also that models will pose more risks sometimes when they have certain capabilities that make these risks more likely. And so therefore, I think these frameworks rely on evaluations of models' capabilities in certain subfields or particular tasks, and use these evaluations to trigger particular safeguards, both on how models are deployed or on the security standards that should be used to secure, for instance, model weights. And so evaluations in that sense play a key role in those frontier safety frameworks. And so it's really important that they be reliable, that they be adapted to the threat models that are used to motivate them. And it's also quite useful to be able to anticipate model performance and evaluations, because if you have some time to prepare and to be able to tell that your evaluation is close to triggering, that's much more useful than if the evaluation triggers all of a sudden and you have to scramble and implement the safeguards without much time. Yeah, so I think I'd say there's like three kind of main categories of work that happen around benchmarking at Epoch, and they all have to do with these issues and how to fix them. One category is building benchmarks. A recent example of that is the Frontier Math benchmark that Elliot is leading currently. And I think that's a good example of a benchmark that is both very difficult, very important in the sense that, you know, I think very high performance on this benchmark would be strong evidence that models are able to automate key parts of research mathematics. Another category of work is consistent evaluation. So we are currently building infrastructure and evaluating models on benchmarks that we consider to be most informative. And we are doing this in a consistent way where we report and control for the prompts and temperatures and other parameters that are used. And our hope here is to communicate key trends in progress on benchmarks while also keeping this level of rigor that makes it easier for people to interpret what these numbers mean. And then a final category is building on top of these benchmarks and doing research about the trends that we see in model performance. So this is things like trying to forecast how well models will do at the benchmarks that we selected in a year, for instance, or depending on how much compute they're trained with or how much reasoning they get to do at runtime. So we think that's really important to investigate these trends and share them with the world and to generally contribute to this field of research around investigating trends in AI progress and trying to forecast model scores on these benchmarks that we consider important.